I can feel the waters rise. I can hear the howling lies that haunt me. Fear won't hold me now. My feet are on the rock. On Christ, the solid rock, I stand. All of the ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands. Our feet are on the rock. On Christ, the solid rock, I stand. All of the ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands.
Here's the mic. It works. Everybody witness this? The mic works. Yeah.
Pittsburgh.
Grayson.
Go ahead.
Welcome in the name of Christ. And for everybody who is streaming in, welcome. Glad that you're worshiping with us this morning. We've got some announcements in the bulletin of which you may want to take note. Ooh, I almost felt like I had the voice of God there for a minute. That was pretty dramatic. So you want to take note of those things. One something that should be obvious, I think, everybody coming in, we've got a Grinch display right out in the foyer, because we're going to be showing the Grinch in 3 weeks, December 9th. What, 6:30? We're going to be so. And if you are really short, or if you sit down, you could get your picture taken with the Grinch. You'd have to you lift it up or set it down, but you could do that. So make sure you set your calendars for that. And next Sunday night, though, we're going to have our tree lighting, which we and this isn't just for the church; this is for the whole community that we started last year on our tree that is bigger this year than it was last, which is kind of exciting. So we're going to be doing that next Sunday afternoon, and we'll have cookies and hot chocolate, and from what I understand, I believe Santa Claus is going to be here, which is going to be really exciting. That's at least what I hear. You'll have to tell me as you track him if he comes here. Okay, so we'll be doing that next Sunday afternoon. No, yes. No, when you said additives, I just that struck me in an interesting way. Oh, candy canes. Okay. Okay. Yeah. Remember, this is a family activity, right? This is a family event. So no. So no spiking the hot chocolate. That sounds outstanding. Anything else? We got a movie that the Brunch Bunch will be showing, Overcomer, on the 8th. So, and there'll be a meal associated with that. Which was great. Great. Yes. When are you going to be doing that?
Next Sunday morning.
Okay. That sounds outstanding. Yes. Oh, that's heavy. So led. That's by who? By God. So, anything else? Yes. That sounds good. Yes, Diane.
I
So keep that in mind. Any other announcements? Yes. Well, no, I think you need to word it different. If anybody feels led by God to do it. Oh, he's already got it, so you don't even need that. Okay. Anything else? Well, I think there's one other thing. If you have a birthday in the next couple of days. You have a birthday in the next couple of days? Oh, my goodness gracious. Oh, my goodness gracious. I knew that. I think it would be appropriate. I think it'd be appropriate to sing. What should we sing, London? What do you think? What do you think we should sing? What song would you like to hear? Jingle Bells. Okay. We are going to sing Jingle Bells, but Scott, you're not, can you? No. But we will do Jingle Bells, so, which I think is a, what's that? Well, let's try an a cappella, which means it'll have a Spanish rhythm. Let's sing Jingle Bells. Jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-horse open sleigh. Hey, jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-horse open sleigh. Yay! Happy... I don't, what's that? Well, I'll tell you, let's start worshiping God together. Amanda, would you come on up here and lead us with some singing? Now let's start with Rejoice, the Lord is King. Let's all stand.
triumph evermore. Lift up your heart, lift up your voice, rejoice again. I say rejoice. Jesus the Savior reigns, the God of truth and love. When he had purged our stains, he took his seat above. Lift up your heart, lift up your voice, rejoice again. I say rejoice, rejoice in glorious hope. Our Lord the Judge shall come and take his servants up to their eternal. Rejoice again, I say rejoice.
And then together let's sing, He is Lord. Y'all may be seated. And would young people come on up and have a seat? If you would, please, everybody come on. Gather around, gather around, gather around. Okay. Well, how's your week? Good, 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 good. What's that? It was you had a crazy week. Tell me about your crazy week. London had friends over. When did London have friends over? She had friends over, and there was a sleepover? Wow. How many friends did she have over? You had five friends over? Okay. What did you do? At this, see, I have never been, and you won't believe this, I have never been to a girl's sleepover. Because when my daughter had them, I usually was working. But what do you do at a girl's sleepover?
Okay, we had a dance party.
You had a dance party? You made your own pillows? Wow. So you decorated a pillowcase? Okay. A movie? What did you watch? Okay, your TV didn't work. We're getting a lot of information here.
Come and help my mother.
We probably are going to move away from this right now. But you had a sleepover. Hey, let me see your... I was going to say, let me see your nails, girls. Oh, man, those are sharp. Those are pretty sharp. Now, I notice your two nails are blank. Is there a reason why these two nails are blank? Is it because those are the nails you use to pick your nose? They fell off. Okay, that's a problem. That happens. That happens. Okay. Anything else interesting happened this last week?
Well.
Okay. Wow.
Like some really cool stuff.
You're going to have movie night and you're going to make cool food?
Yeah. Or I think we might even make these Reese's peanut butter cup trees.
Wow. So that's really is neat.
Like at the bottom, it starts out with one of the small ones.
Uh-huh.
Then you put chocolate icing on it.
Now you're putting icing on the Reese's thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Uh huh.
And then you put another small one on it, and then you put a Hershey's on the top.
Whoa. That's a lot of chocolate.
Yeah, and then you get to pick a color of icing and swirl it around like it has
Ribbon
on it.
Okay. Is there any way you could get more sugar into this, do you think? Yeah. I was thinking the same thing. How do you go to sleep with all that in you? And you're going to do that, and then after you do that, I already know, you're going to do your nails, right? You guys aren't going to do your nails?
No. Then we're going to be
pre-lighting. Oh, neat. Sounds like a winner. Sounds like a winner.
Great.
Then?
This morning was absolutely crazy.
Okay, tell me about how crazy this morning was.
So, I woke up.
Uh-huh.
6:52.
6:52. Not that you were looking at the clock or anything.
Then, I went to my mom's bedroom.
Okay.
Woke her up.
Okay.
Upstairs,
okay.
Woke her up.
Woke her up.
Then I went back down, asked her if I could watch TV.
Okay.
I said, yes, I watched Homeward Bound.
Homeward Bound, okay.
Okay. A few minutes later, I was playing with the Polar Express.
Okay.
Before that, I found my elves on the curtain rods.
Well, I saw pictures of your elf on Facebook. They were on the curtain rod?
Yeah.
Whoa. Wow, they weren't on the curtain rod on the picture I saw.
And then?
I played
with the
Lord. Yeah,
then I forgot to get dressed.
You forgot to get dressed? That's pretty important.
And then I got dressed.
Well, thank heaven.
And then I ran out the door.
Wow, that was a busy morning.
Yeah, it was.
That's a lot of morning, right? Yeah, that's a lot of money. Hey, let me tell you, we are going to talk about, now this is something that I think you've heard about before. Do you know what a king is?
Yes.
Do you know what a king is? Been there, done that, okay. Tell me, what is a king? Tell me, what is a king? I'll tell you, if a king was walking down the street in Sligo, how would you recognize him? How would you separate him from other people?
Well, he has a crown.
He has a crown. Okay, King said. He has a fancy suit on like me. I've always felt kind of king-like, you know. Maybe a cape. Maybe he's got a crown. He's got a suit.
More
He's got to keep more. Wow. Wow. That, you know, sometimes people say things that hit you hard, right? Where you, yeah, a lot more hair. Well, yes. But you couldn't tell because I'd be, you know, he'd be wearing a crown, right? You didn't think about that. Yeah. Okay, so that's how you tell. What we're going to talk about. Now, what are some of the things kings do? So that's how they look. What do kings do? They rule things. They own a throne. Yeah. He doesn't have to make his bed because he has maids. So that's not one of the things he does. So people serve him. Well, what we're going to do today is we're going to talk about a king. Only it's not like the kind of king you're talking about. It's a guess who it's about. Just take a stab at who we're talking about. Jesus. When in doubt, say Jesus. Jesus is the king. And we're going to talk about how Jesus is like our king. And so that's what we're going to talk about today. And that's what you're going to be working on. Not like Burger King, no. We're going to be doing that on the little sheet. So let's bow our heads and let's have a word of prayer. Grace, I don't know what to say. Let's have a word of prayer. Lord God, thank you so much for giving us this opportunity and help us to recognize you as King. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen. Okay, everybody stand. Everybody stand up. Everybody stand up. I think we need to say Thanksgiving. I think we need to mention something about Thanksgiving, don't you? To have an outstanding, outstanding week. And what do I want you to remember all week?
God loves us.
Happy Thanksgiving. Happy Thanksgiving. Okay. Yeah. So let's take this. Wait a minute. Dunt, dunt. Okay, get your crayons and we're good. Well, we come now to the part of the service when we have the opportunity to lift our prayers to God. Now, we've got some particular needs right on the back of your bulletin that you might want to take note, which you may want to take note. Are there any additions to the sheet? Now, we want to pray for our sister Amy, who's here. She's had Lyme's. So we want to lift her up in our prayers that she continues to feel better. Anything else that we want to remember that's not on the list? Yeah. Okay.
And he's having surgery tomorrow.
So absolutely.
And Brooke Schmader from Reimersburg area, she's fighting cancer too. She's young.
Okay. So we want to lift them both up in our prayers. Thank you. Yes, Tom. Absolutely. You got somebody coming in.
Ian and his family are coming up, and our in-laws are coming from Louisiana.
Coming from the South, deep South. You got to watch them. Yeah, those Southerners are dangerous. So we want to pray for those who are on the road, because there'll be a lot of people. I know Maggie, our daughter, is coming home tomorrow. So we want to make sure everybody who's on the road during the next week, we want to make sure they're safe. So, yes.
Just an update on Tad, the little 2.5-year-old that has been diagnosed with cancer. He is back in Philadelphia. He is going to have 6 months of chemo, followed by 5 months of radiation. So, but the fortunate thing is they're going to be able to do the chemo and radiation at Hershey, and he lives around that area. So just prayer for that whole family. Yeah.
That's a tough one.
Marshall wants you to pray for his holy pants.
You have holy pants?
I had a pair of pants with a hole in them.
Oh, you had a pair of pants with a hole in them. So you want us to pray for your pants?
The holy pants.
Well, you know, holy pants are kind of special. Yeah.
I was wanted to ask prayer for, there were three little kids at Claren Elementary, fifth, third, and I don't know if it was first or kindergarten, lost their mom in a car accident on Friday. Dad isn't in the picture. They may have to leave the state to go with grandma, and it's just a mess. So just prayer for those little kids.
Thank you.
An update on Tracy. They did operate on Friday. They put a rod in her leg, a piece of cadaver bone, and a new plate. So it'll be 6 to 8 weeks of non-weight bearing for her. And a joy, I announced at session, the bazaar cleared $2,619 this year. That's $500 more than last year. So
I think that deserves an amen. What is the money going to be used to?
It goes to the social hall for upgrades.
Okay. Upgrades to the social hall and upgrading on bus.
He wants to go to Florida.
He wants to.
I just wanted to ask prayer for the youth group. We are really trying some new things with them. We were fortunate last week, one of the fathers of the kids was willing to give of his time once a month. He said he would come on a Sunday afternoon and play with the kids a little bit harder than the three of us can do. And so that was a blessing. That was Anthony Connor that came and is willing to do that. We really need another person or two to step up. And just if you're willing to give a little bit of time on a Sunday afternoon between 3 and 4:30 to just come in and play with the kids. We have games. They know what they want to play. We just need a little more help. And pray for the ones that say they're coming every week and they haven't made it yet. We have about 4 or 5 kids like that. And I just try to keep encouraging them. But please pray for this group. Thank you.
There's one thing, though, we got to clear up here. Paul and I did pretty good with those games last week. We held our own. I didn't do much the next day because I was recovering. But neither one of us broke a hip. So, yes, absolutely. Pray for not only the youth, but that folks feel called to help out. Anything else we need to remember? Well, with these in mind and also the concerns that we have in our own heart, let's go to God in prayer. And since we're about to hear God's word read and proclaimed, part of the prayer will be confession. So we're ready to hear the word. And then there'll be a time of silence for you to lift these concerns up to God. And we'll close with the Lord's Prayer. So let's go before God now. Lord God, before we say anything else, we got to thank you. My goodness gracious. We're entering this week of thanks. So help us to be focused this week on offering the thanks that we want to express. We've been given good lives here. And help us never to take those lives for granted. Certainly compared to what folks are dealing with in other parts in the world, you have truly blessed us. So help us to be truly thankful as we look at what you've given. Now, in just a little bit, we're going to hear your word read and proclaimed. But before we do that, there's something we need to confess. Today, we're focusing on you as king. And a king rules, and a king has authority. And the subjects of a king listen when the king speaks. And Lord, that's something we need to confess to you, because sometimes we're not real good at listening. You've told us what you want us to do. It's not rocket science. You don't We don't even need to dig that deeply into your word to know. You've said that we're here to love you and to love one another. And yet sometimes we find that to be really, really challenging. Whether it's just challenging to do may be the case, but Lord, often we just have a hard time doing it. So we're going to ask as we move into this week, help us to not only hear the words of our heavenly King, Jesus Christ, but also help us to actually do it. Help us to hear your command that we are to love you and love one another, and then help us to do that as we go about our daily living. Help us to be your subjects. In the name of Christ we pray. And now in the privacy of our own hearts, we're going to lift up to you the concerns that we heard shared. We're going to lift up to you those needs that are on the bulletin, and we're going to lay before you all those things that weigh heavy on our heart. Lord God, hear us now as we pray. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for listening to us. And of course, thank you for loving us, because that's what you do. That's who you are. But right now, thank you for forgiving us, and we know we've been forgiven. And thank you for responding to our needs, and we know that you will, because we've lifted these prayers up to you in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, who taught us to pray, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now, would the ushers come forward to collect our offering?
Mountains will all bow down. When you breathe, there is life. The dead raise up from the ground. We're gonna lift you higher. We're gonna give you praise. You're gonna reign forever and always. Over the fears that we're facing, over the prayers that we're praying. That we're taking, we know, we know.
word of prayer. Lord God, thank you for giving us the opportunity to make this offering to you. Guide and direct the leaders of this congregation that these are gifts, that they may be put to good and effective use. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen. Now, y'all may not know this, but today is pretty important. It's a pretty important day. At least it is around the church. And I say that for two reasons. I mean, first, this is the last Sunday in the church year. The last Sunday in the church year. You see, according to the church calendar, today marks really the beginning of the end, because next Sunday we kick off a brand new season in the church called Advent. It's the first Sunday in Advent next week. But let me be clear, just because Sunday or Saturday will officially end the church year, that doesn't mean you can go home and tear down the decorations or take back the presents or put the turkey back in the freezer. Now, we got 41 days before the ball falls, which includes Thanksgiving and Christmas and Black Friday. But according to the church calendar, we're heading into a new year right now. And that's one reason why today is important. The second reason, and again, according to the calendar used by Christian churches, today is called Christ the King Sunday. You see, before moving into Advent on the last Sunday in the year, and all the stuff that leads up to his birth, on this one day, traditionally, Christians have focused on his kingship. In other words, we intentionally think and talk about what it means to say that Jesus Christ is king. And even though I'm not what most Presbyterians would call a traditional kind of guy, that's what we're going to be doing this morning. And I'll tell you, I think it's a pretty good thing to do, regardless of the time of year or the traditions, because I got to tell you, I'm not sure most Christians really understand either the nature of Jesus' kingship or the significance of calling him king. Now, don't get me wrong, most believers have no problem saying it. You know, saying Jesus is king. The problem comes when we start talking about what that means. And since for most of us, our image of king comes from places like history books, right? And fairy tales and nursery rhymes, I think it's really easy for us to kind of get the wrong idea of Christ the King. I mean, instead of the indulged, you know, kind of arbitrary monarch, you know, we run across from where we've looked in the past, and I'm talking about men that people either fear or try to overthrow, the kingship of Jesus Christ is really special. It's unique, unlike anything we find in the world. And for that reason, we're going to spend some time this morning talking about what it means to say that Jesus is king. And to do that, we're going to take a passage from Paul's letter to the Colossians, one that dealt with how God rescued us from the dark power of Satan and brought us into the kingdom of his dear Son, something that we're going to read in just a little bit. And we're going to use this scripture to consider the kingship of Christ. And I'll tell you, when we do, I think we're going to find that as king, Jesus did and does three things that are critically important for not only us, but for everybody as we go about living our lives. Now that's the plan for today. And I'll tell you, it starts with a passage Paul wrote to the Christians who were in the church in Colossae. men and women whom he'd already described when he said this. Each time we pray for you, we thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. We have heard of your faith in Christ and of your love for all God's people, because what you hope for is kept safe for you in heaven. You first heard about this hope when you believed the true message, which is the good news. You see, it was to these faithful, hope-filled believers that Paul wrote this. His glorious power will make you patient and strong enough to endure anything, and you will be truly happy. I pray that you will be grateful to God for letting you have part in what he has promised his people in the kingdom of light. God rescued us from the dark power of Satan and brought us into the kingdom of his dear Son, who forgives our sins and sets us free. Christ is exactly like God, who cannot be seen. He is the firstborn Son, superior to all creation. Everything was created by him. Everything in heaven and on earth, everything seen and unseen, including all forces and powers and all rulers and authorities. All things were created by God's Son, and everything was made for him. God's Son was before all else, and by him everything is held together. He is the head of his body, which is the church. He is the very beginning, the first to be raised from death, so that he would be above all others. God himself was pleased to live fully in his Son. God was pleased for him to make peace by sacrificing his blood on the cross, so that all beings in heaven and on earth would be brought back to God. Now, that's what Paul wrote. And I'll tell you, based on what he said, I think we could say three things about the kingship of Christ, each of which can affect us in three very different ways. For example, first, according to Paul, as king, Jesus is the creator. In other words, he's the origin of all things, including some of the stuff that we as human beings assume that we've done for ourselves. And I think that's exactly what Paul was getting at when he wrote, Christ is exactly like God, who cannot be seen. He's the firstborn Son, superior to all creation. Everything was created by him, everything in heaven and on earth, everything seen and unseen, including all forces and powers and all rulers and authorities. All things were created by God's Son, and everything was made for him. Now, that's what Paul said, which, when you think about it, isn't all that different from what the evangelist John wrote at the very beginning of his gospel. I mean, John said, in the beginning was the one who is called the Word. The Word was with God and was truly God from the very beginning. The Word was with God. And with his Word, God created all things. Nothing was made without the Word. Everything that was created received its life from him, and his life gives light to everyone. You see, as King, Jesus is the Creator. And you know, I think that's something really important for us to remember. And I'll tell you why. It's sort of like what we talked about last week. Now, you remember last week. Sometimes we as human beings, well, I don't want to put it delicately. Sometimes we as human beings get a little bit big for our, yeah, you know what I'm talking about. And the more important we think we are, the bigger we seem to get. And it's not because the britches are getting smaller. In other words, whether we're talking about stuff that's global or things that are really, really personal, we seem to assume that it's really about who? Us, right? It's about us. We are sort of the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. And that if we don't do it, man, it won't be done. And without suggesting that God wants us to sit around and do nothing, we, and if you're going to write anything down from today, this is what you want to write down, we are not the creator. We're not the creator. We never were, and we never will be. As a matter of fact, the very best we can do is to manipulate the stuff that Christ has already made. That we can do. But man, we can't create a thing. You know, that's not who we are. And I think we need to remember that when our egos kind of get the best of us and we start seeing ourselves as God's gift to God. Or on the other, in the other direction, when we feel overwhelmed by duties and responsibilities that, let's get real, are way above our pay scale. You see, at those times, I think we need to remember that Jesus is the creator. And that's the first way he's a king. And second, again, according to Paul, he's also the sustainer. And I'm talking about the one who upholds everything that he's made. In other words, as king, not only did he create all that is, he maintains his creation. And in my opinion, that's exactly what Paul had in mind when he wrote this. God's Son was before all else. And by him, everything is held together. He is the head of his church, the head of his body, which is the church. He is the very beginning, the first to be raised from death, so that he would be above all others. You see, for Paul, Jesus holds everything together. Something we also see right at the beginning of the letter to the Hebrews. Long ago, and in many ways, and at many times, God's prophets spoke his message to our ancestors. But now at last, God sent his Son to bring his message to us. God created the universe by his Son, and everything will someday belong to the Son. God's Son has all the brightness of God's own glory and is like him in every way, and by his own mighty words, he holds the universe together. You see, Jesus sustains his creation. And I think that's pretty good news for us. And I say that for two reasons. I mean, on one hand, when our lives become really confused and chaotic, and have you ever had a life that's confused and chaotic? Good night. Grayson had one this morning. Confusing, and it seems as though everything is coming apart at the seams. I've said this before, when you're in that great rat race of life and you feel as though the rats are winning, it's nice to know that someone way wiser, way smarter, way better equipped, way more capable has his hand on the throttle. You see, we might actually find comfort knowing that chaos is never going to win. Never going to win. On the other hand, though, I think it also offers us a challenge. You see, according to Paul, one of the ways Jesus maintains his creation is through the church. In other words, through what? Us. And even though that doesn't mean that it's all up to us to keep everything together, I believe it does challenge us to come together as best we can, to come together as a body, as a community, and to together do the stuff God has called and equipped us to do. So along with feeling comfort, we can also find a challenge because Jesus is the sustainer. And for me, that's the second way he functions as a king. And third, along with creating and sustaining as king, Jesus is also the Redeemer. In other words, through him, we have peace with God. But more than that, We also have the opportunity to enter a genuine relationship with the one who loved us before the light first shone in the darkness, and who will love us long after time has lost meaning. Jesus is our redeeming King. And I believe that was Paul's point when he wrote, God himself was pleased to live fully in his Son. And God was pleased for him to make peace by sacrificing his blood on the cross, so that all beings in heaven and on earth would be brought back to God. Now that's what Paul said. Something that I believe Peter understood when he wrote this in his first letter. You were rescued from the useless way of life you learned from your ancestors. But you know you were not rescued by such things as silver or gold that don't last forever. You were rescued by the precious blood of Christ, that spotless and innocent lamb. You see, Jesus is most definitely our Redeemer. And I'll tell you, because of that, we have been set free. Now, do you believe that? We have been set free. I mean, we've been set free from all those rules and laws that we've been told will make us right with God. And I'm talking about all those words we're supposed to say, and all those promises we're supposed to do, and all those works we're supposed to accomplish that will make us acceptable to God. I'll tell you, from all that, we've been set free. Because not only did the blood of Christ wash away our sins, it wiped out the whole idea that redemption is something that we have to earn and something we've got to deserve. We've been set free. But that's only half of it. Because we've also been set free simply to trust. To trust that the Father's love has always been present. And to trust that through Christ that love was shown. And to trust that in spite of ourselves, the Holy Spirit is flowing around us. And he's opening our eyes so that we can see. And he's opening our minds so that we can understand. And he's opening our hearts so that we can feel the grace and the compassion and the mercy that God freely gives. Man, we are now free because Jesus is our Redeemer. And that's the third way he acts as our King. And that's something I think we need to remember as we move past this Sunday and enter a new church year. I mean, as we're cooking the turkey, and as we're buying the presents, and as we're putting up the decorations, let's keep in mind that we're doing it because Christ is the creator and the sustainer and the redeemer. In other words, as we enter the season of Advent and focus on the child whose birth we'll be celebrating in 35 days, Jordan and I had a slight disagreement about the number of days.
33 days.
See, that's what I mean. Can we come to the middle and say 34? Yeah, let's compromise. Okay, because it was 33 and some hours. The birth of the coming of the one who was born on December 25th. Okay, let's remember that we're looking at someone who is far more than an infant, because Jesus is. Let's pray together. Lord God, thank you so much for sending your Son to be King, but not like the kings who tell us what to do, who are rich and powerful, and that we may resent. That's not your Son as King. Remind us that as King, your Son is Creator. And as King, he's sustainer. And as King, he's redeemer. and help us feel the peace and the confidence and the hope that that King offers. We ask this in the name of Christ, our Lord and King. Amen. Now, before we stand and sing this last song, and Amanda, if you would, come on up. Let me offer you all this invitation. If anybody here might feel the grace of Jesus Christ, the love of God, and is interested in how he or she might respond, talk to me after the service. If you've got a question about the sermon or the service itself, come and talk to me about that as well. And so now, what are we singing?
We are singing Lead On, O King Eternal.
Sounds good.
And for those of you that took that last song high, I'm going to be looking for you for this one. So, please stand.
Thank you. Man, that was so high it hurt. It was so high it hurt a little bit. Thank you. Thank you, man. And thank you, Scott, and thank you, Jake. Brothers and sisters, go now in peace. And be challenged. Be challenged to remember that Christ is King. That everything you see was created by him. That he sustains that which he made. But maybe most personal to us, that as King, he redeems us so that we can enter a relationship with God. Be guided by Christ the King. And to empower this walk, receive the blessing. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And the people of God said, Amen. Amen. Amen.
We live to make